The cost of virtual and hybrid events.
Oh, ooh, my favorite topic.
We love technology.
Okay, so in your world, how are you encouraging your customers and your industry friends in terms of budget allocations?
You know, the funny thing is I was actually talking to an ex-colleague of mine about what exactly is hybrid meetings today, right? Because we said face-to-face, virtual. So what is hybrid? I said, well, in all honesty, hybrid is just face-to-face plus virtual mixed together. But a lot of the times, right, clients will say that they didn't realize that hybrid meetings is actually more expensive than a face-to-face or a virtual on its own. So we put together sort of like this two-page or one-page brochure to say, why is it more expensive? It's because you're basically marrying two types of events together. So there are common cost planning factors, right? Like there is still gonna be event management, there is still gonna be attendee management, whether it's virtual or hybrid. But when it comes to a hybrid meeting or face-to-face and virtual, there are individual elements that are gonna cost you separate things. If it's virtual, you're paying for the platform, you're paying for online tech support, you're paying for the streaming and the virtual AV technology. But when it comes to face-to-face meeting, you are also paying for the venue, the meeting package, the room rental, F&B and so on. So
once team members, restaurant table.
So then, and then there is the cost of online manpower versus on-site manpower as well. So naturally the cost gets boosted up. So, but when it comes to technology per se, I think that's going to be, you get what you want to put in. What do you want to get out of the technology itself? Do you want a very fancy meeting? Do you want to have your branding everywhere? Or do you want to focus on the attendee experience? If you want both, then naturally you're going to pay much more for the technology as well.
So can I ask, when it comes to hybrid events, how much more when it comes to percentage?
Ooh, tricky question. I would honestly say it can range from between 20 to 50% more expensive as well, because it depends on the scale of the hybrid meeting, right? If you have more people attending online versus and then lesser people meeting face-to-face, then your cost goes down as well, because then you need a smaller venue space per se, and the cost for how many people are attending online, it's very minimal variation in terms of the change. But if you have 250 people attending face-to-face and then only 50 people online, then naturally you're paying more for it, because then the technology that you need and also the space that you need then goes up as well. So I would say 20 to 50%, think about the scale of your events and the type of technology also.
Would you agree with that, like that amount of
I think so. I think it's, don't underestimate it, right? I think it, again, it's a level of, but we're just gonna plug a laptop in and, you know, use Wi-Fi and connect to hundreds of people. It, the reality of that is so far from that. It takes a lot of thought, it takes a lot of planning, because you've got two different experiences that you want to marry into one message, one strategy. How do you do that, right? And it's, you know, I think that event planners are very underestimated, because you're going to need somebody that's going to, number one, bring those experiences together to be able to coordinate, and then you're going to need somebody to be able at that mid-level to be connecting the AV people on site versus the other technology
people
online, and make sure that there's no dub over and all those small things that you think are just going to happen. It doesn't. Yeah. So I think technology prices will go up. And again, what we, you know, what we've discussed many times before, it's knowing what it is and what it should look like.
Yeah.
Demonstrate it, right? Case studies, I think at this time are going to be so important, because a lot of people, you raise the point, people, you say, we're doing hybrid meetings. A lot of people don't actually know what that means.
Yeah.
They're just like, okay. And nobody wants to sound like they don't understand, and it's okay if you don't, right? Ask the questions and allow the agencies to work with you to tell you and other partners. I'm all about the relationships and the connectors, right? Be informed, and then you can decide what you want to scale up to and what you want to scale down to, and manage expectations in that way. But I definitely think don't underestimate the cost around both.
Yeah, and also don't underestimate what technology can do, right? Because what you can get out of a Zoom platform or a BlueJeans platform is very different from what you will get out of a Cisco or IBM platform as well. So what exactly is the experience that you want your audience to be going through? Because if you want to put people in Zoom breakout rooms, right, you need to have a moderator at the back end send them to these breakout rooms. And that's fine, it works for some smaller meetings. But if you want to have a big audience where you want your speaker against a green screen with his presentation right beside him as well, because branding and marketing is going to be the biggest ROI for you and product launches, for example, that's going to be your key KPI, right? You'll be investing in a different set of technology altogether, and using your company's Zoom account will cost you much lesser than paying for a separate technology account where everything is just clicked through and so easy for your audience. So the question to always ask your event planners or your clients is, what exactly are your top three KPIs? And then what would be your next three KPIs? And then you recommend the technology and the platform accordingly as well. And in some instances, as an agency, we are as honest to tell the client, you don't actually need us because your Zoom platform would work just fine. There's no value add that we can bring, so there's no point paying us X amount of dollars. At least I like to be that level of honesty, right?
And then you're giving them an option.
And then on the other side of the coin, we'll say your technology is going to cost you maybe $50,000 for this platform, but that's because you're going to be getting this. You have green screen technology, you have vMix, you have your studio rental, so your speakers don't have to worry about their home office in the background. The click-through technology is your audience has all of their personalized agenda, so you see what you're supposed to attend, I see what I'm supposed to attend. We don't cross paths and get confused as to 10 selections, which one do I go into? And that's why it costs you a five-figure sum. You can halve the cost if you want to do this instead. So technology is expensive, but if you give your clients options, they'll know absolutely which one works best for them based on top three KPIs and the next three. Give them a focus point of what they want to achieve out of the event in the first place.
I find choosing technology is a little bit like choosing from different mobile phones and different capacities of mobile phones. You know, so what are some of the top three advice which you would give when it comes to guiding people to choosing the right platform for virtual events?
Well, I would say first of all, think about where your participants are coming from.
Okay, where they are based?
Yes, where they are based as well, because we have instances where clients say, I want to do an 8-hour event, but I have clients from Australia to India. That's a 4-hour time difference. When are you going to do lunch? When are you going to do breaks as well? And then also think about your demographics of your audience. Are your audience millennials and Gen Zs? And Google did a research on this, right? That says Gen Zs, millennials, what do they expect out of their technology or mobile phone? Many apps, they want to be able to communicate, versus what your boomer generation are expecting out of their mobile phone. I just want to be able to call. You know, I just want to know where everything is and not worry so much. Phone has to be big and stuff like that. Speaking on behalf of my parents. But
not customers, of course.
Yes, not customers, my parents.
A present company excluded, I hope.
I like that. Knowing your audience is very important.
Because that affects the technology that you're going to pick. Do you pick a platform that is more complex, that has your renderings of your virtual venue? So I click in, I see, I see the entrance to the conference venue. I click in, I see a lobby, I see a help desk, I click here to go to the main plenary. That's fine for a millennial and Gen Z because I love clicking through it like as if it's a video game. But you talk about people who are just there and want to focus on the content, these gimmicks and this virtual view doesn't work for them. They just want to see, what's my agenda? This is the session I need to attend to now. This is the break, this is the breakout track I'm going for, and that's it. And it affects your cost because different technology platform is it's going to cost you differently. So advice for the clients, you need to know what to expect out of your audience. You want to know what exactly is the ROI that you're going to be getting back. Know your budget as well, and know the time that you're going to be planning.
I like the advice, you know, don't go for a super fancy platform if your participants are not inclined to use it. You know, because if not, I mean, of course, if you have a separate brand marketing strategy, because of viewing pleasure, or you know, having brands all over the white label framework, absolutely, if that's your strategy. Can I ask, what about connecting with our participants in China? because obviously they have like firewall. So what platforms are workable for us to connect to our friends?
Yeah. I think we walk backwards when it comes to China. So when we talk about the rest of the world, we think about the platform and the technology first. When we look at China, we think about what can they access first, and then we build a platform around it. So for example, in China, you don't have access to YouTube. You don't have access to Google, Facebook, and so on. But their streaming platforms are on Baidu, Youku. So are your platforms able to patch into these instead? Then that's where we work around it. Do we need to set up with an AV partner VPN links? So the links that we get in Singapore, or the Singapore participants get, versus the links that your China participants get are different. And then they don't share these links among themselves because firewall differences. And it's not just China, you know, you'd be surprised even in certain cities in India, it's also the same concerns as well. So you work backwards depending on the location that you're dialing in from. You don't look at the platform first. You look at what streaming platforms or streaming channels are available in that market, and then you weave it back into the...
So is there a platform that can work with Baidu, for example?
I would say there are a number of platform providers that can work with Baidu. Some of them would be, I guess, On Air is one of those that would work very well with them. C-Vend, I believe via VPN, you are also able to. So actually, if you think about it, if you're able to connect via VPN, you can work with almost all of these platforms. But you need to, as a client, work probably with a separate vendor because it's hard for you to navigate this China firewalls on your own.
Yeah, and do we have to adjust our expectation in terms of connectivity? Because sometimes it drops off when especially with VPN, right? It's never a guarantee. So how do we navigate the conversations with our customers who do have 100% connectivity expectations?
Yes, we have this all the time. The clients are like, I expect 100% attendance, and we tell them the reality of the situation is there's also a chance that your speaker will drop off online, not just your participants. So how are you going to work around this? And then that's where things like tech support is so important, because sometimes clients say, I can do the tech support. I don't want to pay extra for the tech support to come in, because I can just have one of my PAs be online to answer questions if people are not able to connect. The other thing also, in all honesty, is do they have the skill set to do it as well? If somebody drops online, then we throw the questions back. Somebody drops online, how do you respond to this situation? If your speaker drops off, how are you going to respond to that situation? How are you going to connect with them if in the first place the internet is already not working? So, and then the other thing that's very important is rehearsal time. If your event is happening on day one, your day zero, day minus one, day minus two, you spend more time on rehearsals than you do on your actual event.
Yeah.
Because you don't prep just your clients for what happens when people drop offline. You have an FAQ document that's sent to your participants beforehand on what happens if they drop offline. Check your internet connectivity, reach out to our moderators at this hotline number. What happens to your speakers if they drop off online is a completely different FAQ document. Do you have a pre-recorded session to play immediately if they drop off live? That's one thing. And also, investment for cost goes up on a virtual meeting, because you're basically paying for a separate line for speakers and backups on top of backups.
Correct.
Yeah. So you pay, for example, your first wired line or landline for speakers is on Singtel. If Singtel drops, then you're automatically connected to StarHub. If StarHub drops, you're automatically connected to M1, for example. So these things naturally boost up the technology cost, part of any event budget, but it makes sure that your speakers are the ones that are first and foremost protected. You may not necessarily need it for all of your 500 participants, but you have an FAQ document that prepares them for situations like that.
Yeah, I love that suggestion. You know, first we think about the audience, then we think about our people. You know, we think about skill sets, because again, comes back to the point how important our industry is.
Yeah.